When President Mandel asked me if I would be speaker today, I thought, what should I talk about? And I asked my brother Paul, who's here, Princeton grad, but good guy anyway. I said I would like to talk about life in science. And my brother, who combines a career in geometric topology and venture capital and chamber music, said, that's okay, you are a scientist. So for a few minutes, I'm going to tell you a little bit about life on the far side. It's a life that I didn't expect to choose. I fell into by accident, and I'm so happy that I did. I've come to realize that the culture of scientific life has special features that make it irresistible. Having come from a family without an academic background, let alone a background in science, and thus having learned the ways of this culture as I grew up in it, it occurs to me that as the parents and grandparents and brothers and sisters and friends of these new graduates, some of whom are considering a life in science, that you might like to know what they will get themselves into. What do we do all day? Here's one very anecdotal view of our world. I think this can be called a view from the far side. Now, I hope that you students know about the far side. If you don't, ask your parents. Better yet, ask your grandparents. The first and defining feature of life in science is that the people in it want to be here. We enjoy this life. Science is fun. My field of genetics and genomics is enormous fun. Those of us doing science nowadays are extraordinarily lucky to be working in a revolutionary period. It's irresistible not to succumb to a sense of unlimited horizons. Every result, regardless of organism or gene or pathway, is part of a whole story that will eventually make sense to us. Every day is to open a gift box from nature. The lesson of evolution is that the natural world is ordered and that people can figure it out. In experimental science, there are hard problems and incredibly hard problems, but there are very few impossible problems. In this way, experimental science differs from pure mathematics, where some problems can even be proven to be impossible. To me, that's a little discouraging. But for experimental biologists, the far more daunting task is integrating our answers in science into a meaningful social context, about which more in a bit. A second feature of our culture is that we respect each other. We hope our students sense our respect for them. This may be obscure at times because the scientific world is a pretty critical place. Criticism and respect might seem to conflict, but they don't. In the best places, they are both obvious. Any one of our ideas is only as good as yesterday's experiment and this morning's results. None of us delude ourselves that we have all the answers. As people who have been in the field longer, we teachers have simply had more opportunities to be wrong. When one's ideas are inevitably frequently incorrect, one develops great respect for good ideas, both for the difficulty of coming up with testable questions and for the hard work of doing the experiment to find out the answer. As teachers, we respect the creative stubbornness of our students who are just beginning to have their ideas work. We've all been there. Of course, the only way ideas get better is by open, unrestrained criticism. But criticism of ideas is coupled with respect for the person having the idea. The idea may be scientifically immature. Most ideas are, most of the time. But the person with the idea is mature to be able to reveal a not fully formed and therefore fragile notion to their fellow students and teachers who will immediately jump all over it. As mentors, we try very hard to let our students see our regard for them. I know we're not perfect at this, but I think students understand that we take them seriously, that we believe in them, both as our students and as the future of the field, and that we are very proud of them. Now, criticism of students by teachers is certainly reciprocated. One of my graduate students and I were teaching a course together more than 25 years ago in Shanghai. Recall that at that time, there was very little contact between our countries. We had developed a routine in which I would explain a concept for a few minutes in English, and then my then student would expand the same point in Mandarin, emphasizing bits where either my English or the genetics had not been clear. But one time, well into the course, after one of my verbal paragraphs, he said nothing. I looked at him. Perhaps I had been perfectly clear, but no. My student looked at the class, looked at me, and said, in English, "There's really nothing I can do with this. You've got it all wrong." I need not mention that everyone in the class understood that comment perfectly. It's an indication of our shared worldwide value system, even for two cultures quite isolated from each other 25 years ago, that everyone laughed. I've been going back to China ever since. The students still laugh. From another lab comes a more positive example. A scientist friend of mine took a job in Washington, D.C. several years ago. He had to testify to Congress about some particularly complex issues. "How'd it go?" I asked. "Oh, pretty well," he said, unexpectedly cheerfully. "My lab showed up to listen and thought I'd done a good job." "Well, what about Congress?" I said. "Oh, yeah, them too," he said. "But my lab is a lot harder to please." This is true. Your lab is where you go for a reality check. In the lab, you'll hear honest responses to your ideas. You also expect and receive loyalty vis-a-vis the outside world. Everybody knows that you let the capillaries run dry and ran the lab out of sequencing reagents, but you are welcome anyway. I've mentioned the fun of doing biology and the critical but accepting life of a laboratory-based community. The last feature of scientific life that I'd like to suggest is the scientist as a citizen of the world. Being a scientist provides a view of the world that is unique and that imposes responsibilities on those of us lucky enough to be part of it. So what do I mean by this? Anywhere we go as scientists in the world, we are welcomed in local universities. Anywhere. There, anywhere, we meet new friends at one or two degrees of separation. We take for granted the internationality of our world and the irrelevance of nationality or race or the politics of one's government. However, we'd be blind not to acknowledge that we're part of the wider world, and that sometimes we must address events of that world. At these times, the technologies of our own fields can be useful. For me, using genetics to identify kidnapped children in Argentina was an obvious example. But probably more often, it's not the science per se that's applicable, but rather our insistence on common sense in public life. We have a long practiced ability to detect nonsense. We are in close contact with a large network of well-informed people from all over the world. In crises, our subculture makes excellent use of those networks. Our internet interconnectedness is a major force for democratic change in all parts of the world. It is impossible to tell bright young people utter nonsense and expect them to believe it, or to be eternally patient with those responsible for it. Friendships made in school, friendships you've made here, can and will impact events beyond science in ways that none of us can predict. So I would like to leave you with three wishes, like a fairy godmother. First, may you have enormous fun and good fortune in your chosen field, whatever it is. Second, may you always have, in parallel with your life in science or in arts, a side life in the other of C.P. Snow's two cultures. If you are a scientist, read history or play an instrument or enjoy a play. If you are an artist, read Gawande's books. Learn a bit about the science that we do and how it can be fascinating as well. Third, may you be fully immersed in our society so your brains and abilities are useful. Notice that these three wishes are not bestowed from on high. Rather, they are completely under your control. You have the freedom and autonomy to choose your wishes and to choose the paths you will follow in fulfilling them. We wish you the greatest pleasure in doing so. Thank you.